Good evening. My name is Brent Sewell. We've been studying and teaching on End Times 101. It's our seventh week, and to get right into it, we have been, our review would be, we took a look at the end times when Jesus did it in Matthew 24. He, for the most part, looked at the events leading up to his coming. But if you look at Matthew 25, it's a continuation of the same Olivet discourse, and he talked about when he comes, he'll give a reward to his faithful, and when he comes in his glory, he'll sit on the throne of his judgment and divide the nations, divide into sheep and goats. And so it's not just a series of events leading to his coming, but what happens at his coming and after his coming. The sequence of events that lead up to it is part of the subject that I want to go back to tonight, because when we establish this sequence, Jesus said in Matthew 24, he said that these events would happen in an order. He had several thens. If you look at Matthew 24, all the way up to, say, verse 31, when he is describing the sequence that comes, that climaxes with his coming, there's about eight or nine thens, so it's sequential. And then if you add a couple of other things, it says immediately after, or it says when this happens, that also puts those things in a proper sequence. If you look at it real close, there's about 10 or 12 events that happen in order. I've narrowed it down to about eight, and came up with a little paper or a roadmap, which here is an example of this roadmap. It's basically a road leading to the day of the Lord. Here's a horizon. It's a road leading off to a horizon when Jesus comes. And his coming in Matthew 24 is the one that's coming in power and glory. And I have also shared, I'm of the opinion, it's a single coming. It's not as if he's coming before these events at any time. He only describes his coming at the end of these events. And those events those things that lead up to his coming, those seven things, are punctuated pretty clearly. There's a tribulation. There's begins with birth pangs, but then he says, but the end is not yet. And then he says, and then they'll deliver you to tribulation. That's as if it's the beginning of the sequence of events with an unknown period of birth pangs. So it's tribulation, then the believers receive offenses. There'll be offenses, and he'll set brother against brother, and they will deliver during this tribulation of believers. They'll deliver you up to councils, and yet the focus on that delivering you seems to be Jerusalem and Judea centered, because it says they'll deliver you up. In Luke, it says they'll deliver you up to Sanhedrins and councils. And so it looks like Jews that believe in Jesus are especially targeted. Sounds like Messianic Jews to me, but that is the target of the offenses. And there is accountability to come before courts, Sanhedrins, if you will. Then, because of the nature of this accountability before courts, says the gospel will be preached in all nations. And then it says, then shall the end come. And so Jesus is describing a series of events, and then he says, and then shall the end come. But when he talks about the end, he actually talks about the abomination of desolation, which is not really quite the end. It's just like the sequence that kicks in high gear for the last few signposts that are on this road. The abomination of desolation is, he says, is spoken of by Daniel the prophet. Now that's where we're going to focus tonight, on the Daniel references that happen in the middle of these sequences that Jesus talked about. Those sequences go on to say, then there shall be great tribulation, He didn't say that before. He said there was tribulation before. Now he says, then there shall be great tribulation such as the world has never seen. And when you see the abomination of desolation, get out of Jerusalem. Let those who are in Judea flee to the wilderness even. He says, hope that your flight is not on the Sabbath. It's all Jerusalem and Judea centered on that, on his warning. And they leave, for then there shall be false prophets and messiahs. And he gives a warning that in that day you may believe, you'll be tempted to believe. Believers will be tempted to believe because of the signs and the wonders that false prophets and messiahs give. So it's not going to be an easy thing unless you're alert to the word. If you don't know the word, it would be only natural that you don't know the truth. And so believers, we've got to know the truth. And know if he comes in our day. And so it's important that we understand the word, not so much that we're tied into the day-to-day life, but that we understand what he's taught us, what he's told us about what's yet to come, so that we are not deceived. He said that just before this, the abomination is the kingdom gospel is preached, and this message will go into all the nations. And in the middle of this tribulation, apparently there is this gospel that continues even to be preached. It says that following the tribulation, this great tribulation, immediately following that great tribulation, there will be signs in the heavens. The sun will be darkened, the moon will be darkened, the stars will fall. It says, and during this time of signs in the heavens, there are also the false signs of the false prophets. He says, but don't you be deceived, because there'll be many saying, Christ is over here, Christ is over there. He said, for this is how you'll know it's me, is what basically what he's saying. This is how you know that it's me. For as lightning shines in the east and so shines to the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. And he gives a couple more signs of his coming in clouds, with a trumpet, with angels. There's a voice. There's a gathering of his angels from all sides. That's the sequence of events that he says. When I'm looking at the scripture, though, I want to take a look tonight at making these signposts. Take a look at some other scriptures. If this is the horizon that the road is leading to, and we have these different signposts, leading up to the day of the Lord and his coming in clouds, and he says one of them is, It's the when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, and I'm just going to make that this one right here. When you see the abomination spoken of by Daniel the prophet, when that happens, then flee Jerusalem. Matter of fact, when he says that, he says in that sequence of events, he says, this gospel shall be preached in all the world, and then shall the end come. He's talking about the end, or the toughest, or the climax of time starts right at this abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet. Well, to get some clarity, since he pointed to Daniel, that's what I would like to look at tonight in a couple of passages concerning this abomination of desolation. What is it? Early on, we did share that Paul made a statement that gives us some more clarity on the abomination of desolation. If you want to just write that passage down to remind you, that's in 2 Thessalonians 2. That most of that chapter, starting from the very from verse 1 in 2 Thessalonians 2. So you'll see some more there. We won't have time to discuss that, I don't think, tonight. I want to take a look at Daniel 9. So in Daniel 9, there is a prayer. There is an understanding of Daniel. He said, verse 2 in Daniel 9, he says, in the first year of the reign of King Darius, I, Daniel, understood by the books the number of the years specified by the word of the Lord through Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolations of Jerusalem. So Daniel's saying, there's a 70-year period that he understands from Jeremiah the prophet. Okay, so we should be able to find that a 70-year period that Jeremiah refers to. And he said, then I set my face toward the Lord God to make a request by prayer and supplication with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes. And I prayed to the Lord my God and made confession. And I said, O Lord, great and awesome God who keeps his covenant and mercy with those who love him and with those who keep his commandments, we've sinned. And so he's humbling himself before the Lord, having seen this 70 years, and he's humbled by this 70 years. We're broken. This is not how you planned for us, Lord, and we have done wrong. He humbles himself on behalf of his people, and as a result, God sends an angel to him. God sends Gabriel in particular. I'm going to skip to verse 20. Now while I was speaking, or he's praying, while I was speaking, praying, and confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and presenting my supplication before the Lord, my God, for the holy mountain of my God, yes, while I was speaking in prayer, the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, reached me about the same time of the evening offering. And he informed me and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I have now come forth to give you skill to understand. At the beginning of your supplications, the command went out, and I have come to tell you, for you are greatly beloved. Therefore, consider this matter and understand the vision. Keep in mind, he'd been looking at 70 years, all right? Now Gabriel is about to explain 70 weeks, okay, which is really a 7, 70 sevens, okay. It says this, 70 weeks, Gabriel's talking now, 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again and the wall, even in troublesome times. And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. Until the end of the war, desolations are determined. Then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. But in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. And on the wing of abomination shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation which is determined is poured out upon the desolate. It's prophecy. It's cryptic until you see some fulfillment. And after you see some fulfillment, which we haven't seen the complete fulfillment of this yet, it starts making a lot of sense. Daniel, none of these events had happened in Daniel's day. Daniel already had understood a prophecy from Jeremiah that the city would be restored. He because he knew there was an end to this 70 years. he may have understood then when Gabriel said, know this, therefore understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem, he understood that it would probably be sometime in the future, possibly in his lifetime, that this command would go out. But after that, it's prophetic from Gabriel. Now, we, looking backwards, can see some things that certainly refer to Jesus in this, but Daniel didn't see them firsthand. Look at, on the 70 weeks, some of the events that we know took place, and we don't know without looking at the number of years, a week, in this case, a week is a week of years, or a seven period of years, 7 years. But look at these things that describe Jesus when he came the first time on earth. It says 70 weeks are determined for your people and your holy city, that would be Jerusalem, to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity. Doesn't this point to Jesus? To finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness. Our salvation was bought when he died, okay, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy. Many prophecies and visions of Jesus in his first coming were fulfilled, and to anoint the most holy. But to carry that out further, there are in these 70 weeks, there's two dates, actually. One, we can tell things that have already taken place. Two, things that looks like they have not taken place yet. And so he says, so Gabriel goes on and says, know therefore and understand from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until Messiah, the prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Seven, group of seven, and 62. I'm going to erase this for a minute. Well, that diagram is right over here on my left. So, seventy sevens. From the going forth of the command, those shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. From the going forth of the time of the command to rebuild and restore Jerusalem, there shall be a couple of groups of weeks. The focus, you might think that the 7 would come first and the 62 come after. I'm not going to focus on anything but the addition of those two numbers, because the scope of this is more than I am prepared to give. But those 70, those add up to, if you look at it, years, that is 69 sevens. So 483 years. The 70 weeks would be one more week, which is one more seven. If I add that would be 490 years are in a prophetic period dealing with the Jews. The focus of the major portion of what we see is already fulfilled. Seven plus 62 weeks, 483 years, leads us to Jesus riding into Jerusalem. Now, there's a guy who, in the last 100 years, 120 years, who focused his attention on this to come up with an interpretation of that scripture. His name is Sir Robert Anderson. He's kind of an interesting character, because you wouldn't think, It's kind of like the Sherlock Holmes. He's a member of Scotland Yard in the late 1800s, and he's dealing with, part of one of the things he dealt with was Jack the Ripper, okay? And but he's also a devout believer who studies theology, and it's given credit to Sir Robert Anderson, this guy in Scotland Yard, who is a detective, and he loves to investigate. Well, he investigated Scripture, and he came to a conclusion which is pretty well accepted in believers today, especially those that look forward to the second coming of the Lord, that the timing of the prophecy that Daniel gives is amazingly fulfilled in this climax that's listed in the first, the end of this 62 plus 7 weeks. The climax is to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to finish the transgression, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, to anoint the most holy. But when Jesus comes riding into Jerusalem, and he's declared, this is where Robert Anderson says that is the climax of those 483 year period. Now, it is interesting. If you want to look him up on Wikipedia, you can find him on Wikipedia. You find some more about his life. He wrote a book about Messiah and the prince that is to come. A small 150-page book. I have not gotten through it all. It looks fascinating to me, and I've picked up some of that. But he's given credit for this particular prophecy. The prophecy that's given by Gabriel breaks down, though, in this 70th week, and that's the focus where I really want to call attention to. This first part is an amazing set of prophecy, but the 70th week is the focus in an end-time study. It says, up to this point, we've got the 69 weeks. It says, after 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. Of course, we know Jesus died for all of us. He didn't die for his own sins. He shall be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince who is to come, this is a different place. The prince who is to come is really Antichrist, okay? So you need to picture that. The people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. Until the end of the war, desolations are determined. So, then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. This prince who is to come is dealing in this 1 week right here. The prince who is to come, okay, is in that week. Apparently, he's on the scene beforehand. It says, he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. Some kind of covenant, some kind of agreement, okay? We're led to believe from other passages that this is a peace agreement, a peace covenant. He shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. Okay, if this is a seven, and Robert Anderson has concluded that these are seven, these are weeks, these are sevens, period of seven, well, then this would be a period of 7 years as well. That 7 years Daniel says in the middle of that week, so we're looking at 3.5 years. In 3.5 years, making a seven, in the middle of the week, he who started a covenant at the beginning is going to break a covenant right in the middle of that week. So approximately 3.5 years, or 3.5 years, biblically speaking, 3.5 years, he's going to make a covenant that he had initiated. He's going to break it. Verse 27, he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering. Now, what's an antichrist doing with sacrifice and offering unless this agreement is, yeah, you can keep up your sacrifice and offering to the Jews, okay? This, you know, he believes he has authority that yes and no, we'll agree, we'll let you do this, implying that there is something going on in the Jewish realm, sacrifice and offering, is okay to this point, and then he's going to break this treaty or covenant. He shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering, and on the wing of abominations. Abomination is something that's a stench to God's nostrils, a stench in holiness. Something is bad. On the wing of abominations shall be one who makes desolate. Cryptically, it looks like, this is my opinion, I guess. I'll express my opinion. There is a place where sacrifices are given. That acceptable place for the Jews is a temple. There are, the temple has wings on it. I mean, just farther extensions and a court outside this, outside the temple, and the presence of the Lord, the curtain and the in the temple is big cherubim reaching over the Ark of the Covenant, and there is the main temple, the court, and wings of the court. It's my understanding that on the wing of abominations, there's something set up over here on one of the wings, something that is highly offensive. Okay, if we look at what Paul describes that as, I'm going to skip, I said I wasn't going to go to 2 Thessalonians, but let's look at what Paul describes as happening, which appears to be this thing that's abomination. 2 Thessalonians 2. Paul says it this way, and he's addressing people that say Jesus has already come, and Paul's saying, no, he hasn't already come. And this is how you know whether he's come or not. When you see certain things happen, then you'll know that the time of his coming is near. He said, now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. He hasn't come yet. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition. In this time before Jesus comes, here is the time before Jesus comes, the day of the Lord, there will be the falling away first. Jesus said there'll be offenses, brotherly set against brother. The love of many will grow cold. This thing will happen early. He said, and Paul is describing that same thing. He said, let no one deceive you, for that day will not come unless a falling away comes first. And the man of sin is revealed. Okay? This man of sin, this abomination, is a revelation of something that takes place right at this period, and this man of sin apparently does it on a wing of the temple. Now, the temple is not built currently, right? Is there a temple yet to come? It certainly looks like from this, from these scriptures. I'm going to go on in 2 Thessalonians, who opposes it, and this is what the man of sin looks like. the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition or destruction, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. This thing that's an abomination is one who calls himself God, sitting in the house dedicated to God, and he apparently is on the wing, according to Daniel, setting himself up as the authority in the temple. I'm going to leave that part because my focus is more on Daniel than it is on Paul's reference. But this thing happens to be the thing that's the abomination that Jesus spoke of when we were dealing in the Matthew. He said the abomination that causes desolation. When you see that, the thing that Daniel talked about, when you see that take place, then leave. Said all that to say this. Daniel has described a 7-year period of which in the middle there is a covenant that's been made for 7 years. It said, this is our agreement, but this man breaks this covenant. This Antichrist breaks a covenant right here, sets himself up on a wing of the temple, showing himself in extreme pride, showing himself that he is God. This is the thing Jesus warned about. There'll be people calling themselves Messiah, okay, in this day. This Messiah figure, I'm going to draw a line here, mess up my paper. But here, this particular sign is the abomination of desolation that Jesus spoke of. And that sign happens amazingly in the middle of the sequence of events that lead to the end time. This is what Jesus said. This is what Daniel said. In the middle of this end time, Jesus said that just before the abomination of desolation, the gospel will be preached in all nations, and then shall the end come. Jesus basically is saying that here is the end of this period right here. Daniel's saying in the middle is when things start shaking. Jesus is saying in the middle is when then shall the end come. This to here is the end of this age. That would give rise, from Daniel's perspective, if we looked at this in Revelation, we're going to see a time in Revelation that refers to 1260 days. Jewish months are 30 days each. That happens to be 3 goes into 12, 4 times. That's 42 months. That's 3.5 years. We'll see in Revelation, we'll also see in other passages, a 1260-day figure concerning the end time, a 42-month figure concerning the end time. Outside of Daniel, we don't see 3.5 years, but we do see in Revelation another period called a time times and half a time. As though a year, a couple of years, and a half a year. So we see all that referring to the last days. John refers to it in Revelation, Jesus having told John these terms. Jesus talks about the abomination in the middle of these last days. From Daniel, we could pick up these last days that Jesus is talking about is 7 years. of which the big focus is the Great Tribulation in this last 3.5 year period. Having gone through an era of, quote, peace, but not really. Having said that, I've got a handout, and you may have seen it or not, but that, compared to the one we just talked about, there is the beginning of a week of, that starts with a tribulation. The middle of the week of years, or 7 years, is in the middle of the week. He shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering, and on the wing of abominations shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation. Well, what's the consummation? When things come to an end. When things come to an end, even until the consummation, there is extreme trouble, extreme pressure on believers in particular. Now, I personally have an issue with something that I drew up here, the temple, okay? Coming back on the scene and sacrifices being made apparently at the temple for these 3.5 years. My question is it pleasing to God? Okay? Because Jesus made the sacrifice once for all. And I'm left with, it looks to me like a reestablished temple where sacrifices are made would be in denial of Jesus. But it would not necessarily be in denial of Jews who do not believe in Jesus. And so I'm of the opinion that this temple is more to satisfy religious Jews than those who are seeking God with their whole heart, and seeking the Lord and discovering Jesus himself. And so I'm of the opinion that this temple, which kind of implies that sacrifice and offering will cease here, Daniel almost implies that that's a good thing. Just because it's sacrifice and offering, it's not saying that's an abomination. It's when the sacrifice and offering stop that it's an abomination. Knowing that Jesus has come, redeemed us from sin, that sacrifices of bulls and goats never really did anything except point to Jesus. If we reestablish things that point to Jesus and say that's sufficient and we need to be doing this, that puts us back into a place that Paul said, don't go there. Do you not know that part of this is all of this was picture, but now that we have the full complete, we don't need the picture anymore. It's unnecessary. And so the temple, in my opinion, very likely will not be anything more than an attempt by zealous Jews to reestablish their traditions rather than something that's pleasing to God. Just my opinion. Do I have a lot of scripture to base that on? All I've got is scripture that several letters of Paul that point to what do we do with many of the Jewish rituals. We set them aside because they were all pictures, and we receive the completion, which is Jesus Christ. Everything was Jesus Christ. The lamb, the Passover lamb was Jesus. The priest is Jesus. The bread is Jesus. It's Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And when he died and rose again, he went before the Father and presented himself the completion of redemption for us, in full redemption, and the blood of bulls and goats no longer does push off the forgiveness of our sins. They're forgiven in Jesus. Okay, having said that, that's Daniel 9. I'd like to look at one more passage of Daniel where the abomination is again, this is a little bit longer passage, but I'm just going to clip off some pieces of it. In Daniel 11, I'm going to go there, And Daniel 11 is really the middle of an encounter with, I believe, the Lord that Daniel had when Daniel was praying and praying for 21 days and doesn't have an answer. He's been fasting and he receives an answer from someone whose description matches what we understand in Revelation 1 to look like Jesus. Okay, so I'm going to say, looks to me like this guy with eyes of fire and feet, burnished brass, and this figure who has all these same qualities that Jesus has when he shows himself to John in Revelation, comes to him. And this one says to, when he comes to Daniel, he says, from the very first time that you began praying 21 days ago, I determined that I couldn't come to you because I was wrestling with the prince of Persia. And had Michael not come, I couldn't come to you. But now I'm here and understand that from the day from the day that you began praying, I was on my way and it got delayed. That starts in chapter 10. And then Jesus, if you will, tells Daniel a series of events that is yet to come in prophecy. And for me to try to explain, it is hard, cryptically, again, to follow the sequence of events, but it gets clearer, I'll say this, it gets clearer when it narrows down to one or two characters in the end of the sequence of prophecies, because it in a nutshell, there's a king of the north and a king of the south, and they tend to cross paths, fight each other, one invades the other invades the other, over and over again. Their generations, it talks about generations and daughters and others, and they have a series of battles over many, many years, and it's all prophetic from when Daniel receives this word, until about verse 21. Okay, at 21, it narrows down to a couple of characters at the end time. And let me read some of it, starting at verse 21. And in his place, which is a king, okay, who imposed a lot of taxes, which sounds like today, okay, in his place there shall arise a vile person, evil person, to whom they will not give the honor of royalty. In other words, he's not going to be a normal king. They will not give the honor of royalty, but he shall come in peaceably. He shall get his rule peaceably and seize the kingdom by intrigue. With the force of a flood, they shall be swept away from before him and be broken, and also the prince of the covenant, which seems to relate to the other one, but if you read on, this one that I just talked about seems to be the one who's in charge. And after the league is made with him, he shall act deceitfully, for he shall come up and become strong with a small number of people. He shall enter peaceably, even into the richest places of the province, and he shall do what his fathers have not done, nor his forefathers. He shall disperse among them the plunder, the spoil and the riches, and he shall devise his plans against the strongholds, but only for a time. He shall stir up his power and his courage against the king of the south with a great army. And the king of the south, this is by the way the king of the north, and the king of the south shall be stirred up to battle with a very great and mighty army, but he shall not stand, for they shall devise plans against him. Yet those of us are those who eat his eat of the portion of his delicacies shall destroy him. His army shall be swept away, and many shall fall down slain. So this king of the south is not as strong as this king of the north area. Both these kings' hearts shall be bent on evil, and they shall speak lies at the same table. But it shall not prosper, for the end will still be at the appointed time. While returning to his land, this is the king of the north, with great riches, his heart shall be moved against the holy covenant. By way of just explanation, come back to verse, where am I? Can you help me out with what verse I'm at? 28. 28, okay. I'm going to erase this for now. This is generally understood, and I agree, that north and south is respect to the Holy Land. Okay, here's Mediterranean Sea and the Holy Land, and what we know as Lebanon right here, and Syria goes on up, I guess. Syria's here, and Turkey's up here. Excuse my drawing, and you got the Africa and this Gulf of and the Arabia, Israel maybe might go down to the Gulf that kind of goes right here. So here's Israel. King of the North and the King of the South seems to be respective to Israel. There is a King of the North and a King of the South, which tends to be Egypt. Okay, it looks like Egypt. Egypt is even mentioned here. You got a King of the North, King of the South, and they're fighting, and they're going back and forth against each other and traversing over the Holy Land. Okay, they're passing through here. And so, on this particular verse, while returning to his land, this King of the North has been invading the King of the South, and while returning to his land with great riches, his heart shall be moved against the Holy Covenant. So he shall do damage and return to his own land. As he's going, he's passing through the Holy Land, and his heart is moved against the Holy Covenant. So he shall do damage and return to his own land. At the appointed time, he shall return and go toward the south. So he's gone here, now he's coming back again. He's going toward the south, but it shall not be like the former or the latter, for ships from Cyprus shall come against him. Therefore he shall be grieved and return in rage against the Holy Covenant. Cyprus is over here, and I don't know if they've just come from Cyprus or the direction of Cyprus, but ships are coming against this King of the South who is passing through the Holy Land, and he's enraged against these ships that are coming from this area over here. All right. While returning to his land with great riches, his heart shall be moved against the Holy Covenant. He's turned against, this king is turned against Israel at this point. Therefore he shall be grieved and return against, enrage against the Holy Covenant and do damage. So he shall return and show regard. So he shall return and show regard for those who forsake the Holy Covenant. He's looking for people disloyal to God in Israel. And forces shall be mustered by him, and they shall defile the sanctuary fortress. The sanctuary fortress apparently is the temple in Jerusalem. And they shall take away the daily sacrifices, which sounds just like the abomination part. Okay, here's this guy. They're taking away the daily sacrifices and placed there the abomination of desolation, just like Daniel 9. This one has come. Those who do wickedly against the covenant, he shall corrupt with flattery. He's going to encourage them to continue to be disloyal to our God. But the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. All right, we just talked about this particular king of the north coming to the south, setting up some in rebellion against some that are coming against him. He's setting up his place of authority here in Jerusalem, and he sets up the abomination of desolation. Well, if that's this point right here, according to Daniel earlier and Gabriel who gave him that word, that is this time in the time of the toughest period. The great tribulation is just about to be set. At the same time, it says, and the he has twisted some to reject truth, but there are those who know their God and shall be strong and do exploits. In my opinion, that sounds like a revival, okay, which is the very thing that this gospel must be preached in all nations before the end comes. There's this revival portion of those who resist this one, and the people that know their God shall be strong and do exploits, do great things. I believe that get attention of the world. Okay? And those of the people, this is verse 33 of chapter 11, and those of the people who understand shall instruct many. The gospel is getting out. Yet for many days they shall fall by sword and flame, by captivity and plundering. Okay. There is revival. There is revival in here. But there's also drastic tribulation. I'm going to use his word. That's what Daniel is saying. Revival, yes. But it's in the middle of the tribulation that the gospel message becomes much more pure. So when they fall, that is when these people, these believers die. I'm going back to verse 33. Yet for many days they shall fall by sword and flame, by captivity and plundering. Now when they fall, they shall be aided with a little help, but many shall join with them by intrigue. They are interested. The gospel is preached, and I believe people have joined them. Okay, so it's not as if they are done away with. The gospel is preached, and people come to Jesus. Okay, now, and some of those of understanding shall fall to refine them. Let me say it this way: some of them shall fall. Some of those of understanding shall fall to refine them, the others. Okay, to refine them, purify them, to make them white until the time of the end, because it is still for the appointed time. In other words, during this time, it's not the end yet, but all of this is to purify the church. Separate those who are fervent from those who are going to be deceived. Then the king, verse 36, then the king shall do according to his own will. We're talking about the Antichrist now, even though he's not royalty, but he's in charge. The king of the north shall do according to his own will. He shall exalt and magnify himself above every god. That's what Paul was talking about. He shall speak blasphemies against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the wrath has been accomplished. That is the wrath of the Lord when he comes. For what has been determined shall be done. He shall regard neither the God of his fathers nor the desire of women. Now they're describing his character. Okay, he shall regard neither the God of his fathers nor the desire of women, nor regard any God, for he shall exalt himself above them all. But in their place he shall honor a god of fortresses, and a god which his fathers did not know he shall honor with gold and silver, with precious stones and pleasant things. Thus he shall act against the strongest fortresses with a foreign god, which he shall acknowledge and advance its glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many and divide the land for gain. At the time of the end, the king of the south shall attack him, this king of the north, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind with chariots, horsemen, and many ships, and he shall enter the countries, overwhelm them, and pass through. He shall also enter the glorious land, saying that this one will bring armies to the glorious land, and some and many countries shall be overthrown. But these shall escape from his hand: Edom, Moab, the prominent people of Ammon. Okay, I'm going to draw that here. This is just an aside. Edom is here. Moab is here. Ammon is here. These immediate countries right here, which are now Jordan and some of Syria, okay, the west, those areas east of the Jordan right here. This king does not mess with these areas right here. That's interesting to me. Verse 41, I just read verse 42, he shall stretch out his hand against the countries, and the land of Egypt shall not escape. So Egypt over here is at the mercy of this king of the north who is passing through and has set up some things in this land. So Egypt is in bad shape during this time. Also the Libyans and Ethiopians shall follow at his heels. Libyans, okay, let's continue this African look. Okay, Africa, basically like this. Egypt, Ethiopia is here, Libyans here. Okay, these all are part of the Egypt problem. Now, Ethiopia, I'm going to put like this, because in the Bible days, Ethiopia was this area down here. And somehow that got renamed Ethiopia up here. This is really more like Sudan. So it quite possibly is Egypt, Sudan, and Libya instead of Egypt, Ethiopia, and Libya. Sudan was Ethiopia by name. Okay. He shall have power over the treasures of gold and silver and over the precious things of Egypt. Also the Libyans and Ethiopians shall follow at his heels. But news from the east, from the east. News from the east and the north shall trouble him. Therefore he shall go out with great fury and annihilate many. And he shall plant the tents of his palace between the seas and the glorious glorious holy mountain. Yet he shall come to his end, and no one will help him. For me, he plant his place between the seas and the glorious holy mountain. It looks to me like he will set up somewhere just east, just west of Jerusalem for his palace. Okay. At that time, I'm going right on to verse to chapter 12. At that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people, and there shall be a time of trouble such there was never since there was a nation. This climax of great tribulation hits a peak right here, the worst time, somewhere in here. Such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. And at that time, your people, he's talking to Daniel, your people, your believing, your believers, your people shall be delivered. It's the coming of the Lord. your people shall be delivered at that time. Look at the sequence that keeps on going. Everyone who is found written in the book will be delivered. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake. There's the resurrection that we had last week. Some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. And those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the firmament, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. And now he's finishing up his thing to Daniel. But you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. Daniel wanted, it's going to get clearer here, but he said, shut up the words. But you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. Look, jump over to verse 8, just so you know that shut up the words and seal the book. It's actually doubled up over here. He says, although I heard, I did not understand certain things, okay? Then I said, my Lord, what shall be the end of these things? I'm going to go backwards in a minute, but catch this part that I'm talking about. And he said, go your way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed till the time of the end. In other words, there was an explanation that Daniel was looking for, and he didn't get. It implies to me that truth of this prophecy that's given to Daniel, he didn't know the meaning of it, but it will be revealed, I believe, to God's people at the end time, which we may be there. Which implies to me that people may have a set of end time understanding that they need to set on the shelf. Because there is an understanding of this scripture yet to come, of this particular prophecy in particular. And so if you hear somebody doing something new, that don't automatically reject it, because this prophecy has been sealed for a while. In other words, we may not see it all. Look at what he said beforehand, that this book is sealed until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. That prophecy of many running to and fro certainly has a much bigger impact in the last 100 years. The last 100 years, planes, jets, cars. We can go across the nation. So, I mean, everything's changed completely, and this definition of many shall run to and fro has taken on a huge fulfillment for the time of the end, for this book to be sealed. It's sealed up for a particular time. Toward the end, he says it twice. Remember, I just covered through it. And there's another piece to it. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. We're in the computer age. In one sense, we're getting dumber. But on the other hand, we're collecting a whole lot of knowledge. And it's at our fingertips. And any one of us can go do a Google search and find out something in the remotest part of the world, because we have this knowledge at our fingertips. We have the ability to be educated at the touch of a keyboard, at the movement of a mouse, in our pocket with a smartphone. I didn't see what time it was when I started. I don't see a clock. How are we doing on time?
7:30.
I'm going to go ahead and draw this to a close. I did want to say one other thing about that passage. Look at uh, look at, I'm going to go ahead and read 5, and that was not part of what I wanted to prepare. But verse 5, after he said these things about sealing up the book, he says, "Then I, Daniel, looked, and there stood two others on the on this riverbank, and the other on that riverbank, which goes to where the Lord was and talking to him. Okay, and one said to the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river, 'How long shall the fulfillment of these wonders be?' Then I heard the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river, when he held up his right hand to heaven and swore by him who lives forever that it shall be for time, times, and half a time, and when the power of the holy people has been completely shattered, all these things shall be finished." This one of Daniel not only had that 7-year period of the 3.5 years at the end of that period, and this is the time of the end of 3.5 years, this one who is talking to Daniel to give this prophecy is, how long shall these things be? He said it shall be for time, times, and half a time from, apparently, if it's consistent with the other prophecy, from the time of the abomination of desolation, 3.5 years. And that's when Daniel says, "Well, I don't understand." And he says, "Daniel, it's not for you to understand. This thing's sealed up until the end time." With that, I'm going to show you a handout that I just basically described, but I didn't show you while we were doing it. That whole Daniel 11 and 12 applies on this same path to the day of the Lord. With Daniel 11, 21 through 27, then the abomination is 28 through 45, a time of trouble such as the world has never seen is Daniel 11 in the 40s there. And then shall be the time when your people shall be delivered. All of this fits the Matthew picture. We could have had this, which is, I agree, is more cryptic and less easy to understand. We could have had this being the structure instead of Jesus' words as the structure. We could have had Daniel 9 as being the structure instead of Jesus. When I say we picked one, here is the one we picked. It's probably because it's simplest for the church of today is why I picked this. It's simple to understand Jesus' words. Now looking backwards, this is a fulfillment of the scripture that's been going forever. The Jews have kept it. The nation of Israel kept the scripture, but he brought it to us and fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And here we have the promise of not us looking backwards on his coming for us now is yet to be fulfilled in the future of his second coming. And he said it's this way when the day of the Lord comes. That's what I have. Thank you for coming and thank you for watching. We'll have more next week.